And now we have Dr. Shaleen Shah, who will be speaking on brow ptosis and blepharoplasty.
So, good evening, everyone. I think we have had a lot of theoretical knowledge. I would like to take you through some of the cases that we commonly see in our OPD, and whether to intervene or not, and how to intervene and correct these cases. So, what periocular aesthetic patients come to us? They come with problems of the forehead and brow, that is one. They come with upper lid issues and lower lid issues. So in the forehead and brow, most commonly we see forehead descent. These are usually 50 plus patients. They have forehead descent, and then associated they have brow ptosis. We often have younger patients who come with brow ptosis, temporal brow ptosis, and resorption of the temporal fat, which is known as temporal hollowing. And there are some patients in the 45 to 50 year old age group who come with a superior sulcus deformity and a resorption of the supraorbital rim and resorption of the brow fat, which is the regression of the supraorbital ridge. Then there are some upper lid issues like aponeurotic ptosis, which is often associated with cases of dermatocolysis or blepharocolysis. There could be orbital fat or lacrimal gland prolapse, which could lead to unsatisfactory appearance. And there could always be some superior sulcus deformity following fat absorption. And there are some lower lid issues like retraction or lower lid ptosis, that is inverse ptosis. Then what we commonly see in 25 to 35 year old patients are lower lid wrinkles and crow's feet, which they are unhappy with. There could also be associated fluid bags, orbital fat prolapse, and a very common tear trough deformity, which we usually see in the OPD. So each of these pathologies, they need to be addressed specifically, and some of them, they can coexist, and we need to offer a comprehensive approach for a full facial rejuvenation in these cases and not just correct one of them. So what do we do? We need to offer a cafeteria approach to these patients. We need to enlist what all deformities or what all issues are there to be addressed, what all can be done, surgical, medical procedures, and then allow the patient to choose what they want to be done on themselves. Because at the end of the day, we have a fraction of patients who are not going to be happy despite all our efforts. And then there are the body dysmorphia kind of patients who, despite best results, would not be satisfied. So we leave the decision to the patient in these cases. So this is one of our cases. This was a 45-year-old lady who presented with excess skin on both of her lids, and it was bothering her. And so we can see that she has bilateral upper lid blepharocolysis, and she also has a tear trough deformity. But she was not bothered by the tear trough deformity or the lower lid wrinkles. She was just bothered about the upper lid. And hence, we planned her for bilateral upper lid blepharoplasty. And so these were her results. This is a follow-up at 1 year. She had sent this photo to us saying that she's very happy and she looks 25 from her age of 45. So, and she was not bothered by her tear trough deformity or anything. Okay, so this was our second case. This was a 20-year-old girl, and the father had brought her with excessive skin over the right eye. And they had noticed this, and she was her marriage was decided, and they wanted a cosmetic correction for this purpose. She also had associated lower lid retraction, but again, the patient was not bothered, and the patient did not want a surgery for that. So she underwent a simple right upper lid blepharoplasty, and she had good correction post that, as can be seen in the photograph. So this was another patient. She was around 25-year-old patient. She had history of recurrent VKC in both eyes. And since last 2 years, she had noticed a slight swelling on the left lower lid. And on eversion, no cyst or anything was found. Only orbital fat prolapse was seen. She also had bilateral tear trough deformity with slight hyperpigmentation, but she did not want any correction for that. She just wanted the lump from the left lower lid to be gone. So we planned her for lower lid fat debulking. And this was her follow-up picture. And she was extremely happy with the result, despite the persistent periocular pigmentation. Now we come to slightly more complicated cases we have faced. So this gentleman was 45-year-old. And his employer had said that you look tired every day. And that's why he had come to us. And we can see he has upper lid fat prolapse, lower lid fat prolapse, and dermatocalysis, and a significant tear trough deformity. And he was ready for whatever procedure was needed to help him look rejuvenated when he went to his office and faced his manager. So we went for bilateral upper lid blepharoplasty with fat excision and lower lid blepharoplasty with fat repositioning in the preperiosteal plane. And I operated this recently, and I don't really have a follow-up of this patient. Now, this was a 26-year-old patient who was extremely bothered by the facial wrinkles and the crow's feet. And he was ready for a surgical intervention, but we offered him microbotox, 2 units into the pre-tarsal orbicularis and 4 units into the crow's feet. And this is the appearance after microbotox, where his creases are significantly reduced. And so a surgical blepharoplasty or an intervention, transconjunctival or skin-based surgery, is not always the answer for these patients. This was another patient who was 40-year-old patient, male patient, who presented with a tear trough deformity which was bothering him, and there was no associated hyperpigmentation. So we advised him fillers, hyaluronic acid fillers in the left lower lid, and this was the appearance after 2 weeks, where you can see that just the filling of the tear trough deformity led to an acceptable outcome for the patient. So, again, non-surgical approach. And so now this patient was an 18-year-old female who presented to us with excess skin on both upper eyelids. And we noticed that she had a slight aponeurotic ptosis in the right upper lid, as well as right lower lid retraction and wrinkles. So we planned her for a blepharoplasty with a right upper lid levator resection and bilateral lower lid microbotox. And she had a very... It's not moving, okay. She had a good correction at 6 months, and she's happy. Now I come to... So this was a patient of facial palsy who left-sided... lower motor neuron facial palsy, who presented with brow ptosis, and she was actually bothered by the dermatocalysis, which was interfering with her field of vision, and we planned her for a brow pexy with blepharoplasty. So in such cases, just a blepharoplasty may not be the answer. And this patient was a 45-year-old female who was bothered by the superior sulcus deformity. On palpation, we noted that there was actually a regression of the supraorbital rim, and we advised her bilateral subbrow hyaluronic acid fillers. And in the suborbicularis plane, we injected the fillers, and this was the appearance at 3 weeks. Okay, yeah, just give me 2 minutes.
Charlene, you have to wind up. It's 5:10. Okay. We have to.
Okay, so surgery or an intervention is not always the answer. So I present two more cases in very brief. So this was a 45-year-old lady who was referred to us for ptosis correction and blepharoplasty of the right upper lid. But on history, we found that she had recurrent episodes. And on imaging, we found that she had bilateral lacrimal gland enlargement, and she turned out to be a case of non-specific orbital inflammatory disease. And we planned her on systemic steroids to control the inflammation. So this is one of the cases where, despite a bulky upper lid and ptosis, we should not operate. And This was one another patient who presented with bilateral orbital puffiness, who was referred to us for blepharoplasty. On extensive history, we found that he had kidney failure, which was missed by the previously examining ophthalmologist, and he was counseled and he was ready for a blepharoplasty, but this is again a case where he needs a systemic correction, he needs dialysis and control of his kidney functions before going for a surgical intervention. So we should not operate every patient with dermatocolysis or fat prolapse that we see in our OPDs. Thank you.